मेहमान जो आने वाले हैं वो कहते न बिछाना राहों में, हम आंख बिछाने वाले हैं। सर, नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट टू आवर चीफ गेस्ट प्रोफेसर एस सी चंद्र साहब टू कम ऑन द डायस। सर, देयर इज अ शेयर फॉर यू। गुलों में रंग भरे बाद नौ बहार चले, चले ब्याहों के भीषण का कारोबार चले। सर, देन आई रिक्वेस्ट टू आवर डीन साहब, डीन फैकल्टी ऑफ मैथमेटिक्स एंड कंप्यूटर साइंस, मिस्टर प्लीज ज्वाइन द क्लास। सर, देयर इज अ Then I request to the convener of the workshop, Professor Pranav Muri Saab and Dr. Reshma Chimchandani to join us. Actually, this is jointly for both of them. मैं कहाँ रुकता हूँ अर्श और फर्श की आवाज से, मुझे जाना है बहुत ऊंचा हदे परवास से। Then I request to our special guest, Dr. Shushmita Mitra, to join the class. एक शेर आपके लिए है, if you like. हालात के कदमों में कलंदर नहीं गिरता, टूटे जो सितारा तो जमीन पर नहीं गिरता, गिरते हैं बड़े शौक से दरिया में समंदर, लेकिन कोई समंदर किसी दरिया में नहीं गिरता। We are very thankful, and then I request to the ocean of knowledge, Professor Karmeshu Saab, a distinguished scientist, to just deliver a keynote. Sorry, it's actually I was not just prepared for that.
Okay, so I just
request. Okay, to Miss Ricky, so okay. As a token of love to our chief guest, Sir Sudhir Chandra. I request Ms. Vanginti Solanki to give bouquet to our dean at OCS.
Soft computing,
What I am discussing is evolutionary dynamics and growth of knowledge and some of the real concerns that why, particularly the SAARC region, we are not able to compete at the international level. And many things I have been discussing this, I have drawn parallel from innovation diffusion, new product, new idea, how does it grow, knowledge grows, and what are the issues. And particularly I am discussing about the ICT, what is the role of ICT in education now. So these are different facets of which I will be discussing. So I have about 40 minutes. What is ICT? All of us know, combination of information technologies with other related technologies, specifically communication technology. So this whole IT and ICT, now yes, information communication technology. And this has led, this has resulted from the convergence of information processing and communication system. This is playing a pivotal role in effective knowledge dissemination, and which in turn leads to sustainability and progress. UNDP Human Development Index, SDI, has an impact on ICT diffusion. Diffusion is a temporal dynamics in the space as well as in time, both you can take. It does not measure ICT penetration or readiness, but indirectly you find Human Development Index, this is 20. It is always beneficial to use SDI as a parameter, showing the position of a particular country with respect to economic productivity, health, education, democracy, quality of life. Now, given a diffusion process, what we mean? Initially, there is a long tradition of innovation research started by sociologists. Rogers at Stanford University, he has listed diffusion of innovations. There are almost 23 disciplines in which innovation in economics, green revolution, how does it propagate, how farmers adopt it, in geography, in anthropology, in sociology, in marketing. So there are different aspects where people have been interested. So there is a long tradition of innovation research. Similarities concerning innovation adoption. What are the characteristics that enhance the rate and effectiveness? That is Rogers. Relative advantage. Why you want to particularly adopt a particular, say ICT? It has to have some relative advantage, only then you will adopt it, otherwise not. Compatibility, complexity, trialability and observability. So any idea which you diffuse across a population, say new mathematical framework you want to diffuse, a new paradigm you want to diffuse, so given a group, target group. So there are knowledge phase, persuasion phase, decision phase, implementation and confirmation. So typically when you find all innovations, empirically they find that there are some innovators who are the initial persons, something like 2.5%, then they are early adopters, then they are early majority, then late majority, and they are laggards. And the same phenomenon you observe across variety of innovation. But now the question is, in knowledge space, are we laggards or are we innovators? That distinction has to be made. So typically if you say that any knowledge or any adoption, number of percentage of adopters, a new paradigm comes, initially the it is a very slow process, then it accelerates and somewhere there is a point of inflection. After that, the rate of change starts declining and eventually it leaves saturation. Once it leads to saturation, then given that paradigm, people have exhausted, then you look for some new paradigm. So there must have been some time when soft computing really came into forefront. Earlier there were issues, and when soft computing and after that new paradigms. So there is a successive generations of new knowledge, that is how knowledge grows. things depend on. Because since I am dealing with ICT, so I have to. So roughly this was. If you look at developed world, typically internet, post density, all these things data is available on internet. And I would suggest whenever you take any data, it is better that one should always give reference. So you find in developed world, this is the rate. And whereas less developed, we are here. And over a period, you find that this particular gap is increasing. And this is global internet usage Wikipedia. We find that in the developed world, it is almost going like this. Whereas here you are finding this is the situation. So innovation diffusion, actually it has been very well studied in the context of marketing, giving any product, what are the channels of communication, one is word of mouth, one is mass media. So whenever they introduce a new product, the mass media becomes a very important thing. And yesterday I was reading that particular this India-Australia match, even companies were paying 10, 25 lakhs for 10 seconds. Because they were thinking, and if India had won, it would have gone into 50 lakhs for the finals. That is the rate at which you are pumping money into word of mouth, in the mass media and word of mouth. So typically this model was proposed by Frank Bass in the context of marketing, giving any product. So this means initially if any adopter, alpha plus beta, alpha is the mass media and beta is the interpersonal context, n into m minus n, m is the target population. So it is this nonlinear aspect, n into m minus n. It is more like epidemic modeling. In social networks, in Facebook, this epidemics, this model was proposed 1929 by McKendrick. And till date, we find a lot of work which is appearing in this context. So this is DN by DT, so all marketing person they are interested in. If you can estimate alpha and beta, then you can say what is the time the product will have the maximum market penetration and what is the optimal time for introduction of the new product. A similar idea you will find. So this is typically you find it grows like this and finally it tapers. And if you look at DN by DT, then you have red curve. So it means the maximum sale will come around this time. And after that it will start declining. And you find that at this time you have to introduce a new technology, new product. Same story about 286 chip, 386, 486. Same story about 48, IBM different versions. When they launch, even if they have the technology, they will not like to launch unless they make full profit. So this becomes a problem of optimal control. What is optimal time? Why I am doing this? All these things you can immediately translate into knowledge domain. And then if you look at this curve for just your interest, the blue curve corresponds to word of mouth and this black curve corresponds to adoption due to mass media. So initially, the mass media plays a very major role, that's why you pump a lot of money initially, and after that it declines, then it's the word of mouth which takes over, and so joint effect you find there is a pattern like this. Similarly, this Bartholomew, they have been interested in social dynamics. Given any innovation, there might be loss of interest. You adopt it, you may lose interest and switch over to something else. Like internet service provider, you join and then you immediately. And incidentally, I was visiting Austin, Texas. Out of 10 endowed chair professors in marketing, 7 chairs have gone to Indians. And there's also very a picture which has been painted in a study by Nirmala Kumar, professor at London School of Economics, at London Business School. He says out of 105 papers in last 20 years, in the top 40 journals, these are the papers from in this country, India. So roughly 5 papers on average, 2 are from ISI, in a statistical institute, 1 from
TIFR Sandeep Juneja, one from ISB, and one from Sanjeev Swami, who was at, he was at Wharton, Wharton came to IIT Kanpur, now he's in there. Not a single paper from top IIM colleges. So question is, for all this, eventually I will come. It is the mathematical framework which is essential. Mathematics has become the language of modern science and technology. Even biological sciences, now we find lot of mathematical frameworks have penetrated and they are driving. So Bartholomew had done, suppose there is a population, alpha is the transmission intensity of the source, beta is the propagation intensity through interpersonal contact, mu inverse is the mean duration of time. Suppose some people are interested and then they lose this interest and they leave it and one second become ignorant. So this is a dynamics. And when mu equal to 0, absence of loss of interest, it becomes a Bass model. Our interest is, so mathematically you find there are three parameters, alpha, beta and mu. So it is the relative strength of these parameters. So we find that if omega is alpha by beta, measure of relative strength of the source, external source and an integral. D is the mean number of contacts and spread of net during effective period. You find a very interesting phenomenon which is called bifurcation. So when alpha equal to 0, when there is no mass media, the dynamics is only taking place through word of mouth and loss of interest, then the differential equation turns out to be this simply nonlinear equation, phi t, 1 minus 1 upon t, phi minus phi square. And if you look at the equilibrium solution, so d phi by dt equal to 0, you get two solutions, 0 and n into 1 minus 1 upon t, d less than 1. So what is important? Now because of this non-linearity, system can get into two states, either no diffusion, no person adopts it, or in this state. In which state system is going to settle down depends on the critical parameter. So it is akin to phase transitions, as in physics you have, as you cool the water, suddenly at a critical temperature, water goes into ice. So that is called phase transitions. And these are the phase transitions here, where so long as d is less than 1, it will not. Suppose you say that the same phenomenon takes place in epidemic. Some people are infected and then they recover. So this is a typical dynamic. And here you want that person should not be in contact so that the infection does not propagate. So d less than 1 becomes a crucial parameter. So long as you can guarantee d is less than 1, epidemic will not grow. If it crosses this, then epidemic will spread. It means mathematically you find that d equal to 1 is a critical point. So long as d is less than 1, the process is not diffusing at all. Only when you reach the critical point, you cross it, you find the system makes a transition from this state to this state. This onset, this is a critical phenomenon. And this is the critical point. So long as you know this critical point, nothing will happen. Similarly, if you are saying that there is a critical funding which is required for research, so long as you are here, even if you change it, if the system does not make a transition, nothing, we say that there is no progress and nothing is coming out, because we are not reaching that critical point which is required for the system to take off. Only once you reach the critical point, you find the system makes a transition from this state. This state becomes unstable and system moves in. Similarly, you can take innovation, diffusion, multiple adoption level, where we are finding that the parameter beta, the word of mouth itself becomes a function of number of spreaders. It is no longer constant, it becomes state dependent. Then one can write down all stochastic processes. Then what one finds? That the fraction, the mean proportion of spreaders or adopters of a technology versus beta. So long as beta is mu, the loss of interest is this, the system has a unique solution. But as you are changing the mu parameter, when you reach mu equal to 12 alpha, the system is on the lower branch and you move up to point C, suddenly you find the system makes a transition from this point to this point, and then the system is on the upper branch. As you lower the point, as you lower the parameter, beta, the system does not make transition here, you have to go all the way up to this point and make it up. And this is called hysteresis effect. And in this case, whether beta is increasing or beta is decreasing, the history is important. And such phenomena are non-linear processes which you find. So in this case, one can also have different aspects of innovation. And this phenomena is also in visual hysteresis effect. This I have taken from Hartman's book. This is face of a man. Tum batate hain.
Ladies.
Confusing. So you find that as you are moving here, your transition somewhere, you are here. You say something. Now you go the other way.
Ladies.
Woman? Man or woman?
Woman.
Okay, so idea of this, these are all experiments which people have conducted in psychology, like the visual stresses that you show. And in this case, what you are finding, as you are changing here, the perception change here. So it means as you are increasing time, and if you are going backwards in time, you are going like this, the perception is changing somewhere. So the history is important, whether you are increasing time or you are decreasing time. And such phenomena are called visual stresses, right? And then people have studied different aspects across the population, alpha and beta parameters. Everyone has different alpha beta. If you take into account all the entire population, then you can treat alpha and beta as random variables. If alpha and beta are random variables, then you find the system depicts a transient bimodality. Initially, suppose I am diffusing ICT in our country. If some persons adopt it, because everyone has a different alpha beta, so what you will find? Initially, you find that in time t equal, it is a unimodal distribution. As you are increasing the time, you find there are two modes, one this. And further, you find that eventually the probability mass will go here. For different set of parameters, you have this, then again bimodal, then eventually is this, again bimodal, then. The question is, if we are diffusing ICT, if some of the persons adopt it very fast, some of the states adopt it very fast, some of the states are very slow, then you have a population which are divided into polarized into two sections. And that is a dangerous trend. Because if ICT diffusion can lead to divide, some people have it and some people don't have it. So that type of development is. So some efforts have to be made. How we should train our trainers, the teachers and this, so that such a phenomena does not take place, that entire population grows, otherwise you will find the population gets divided, segregated, and if you have higher order non-linearity, there are multiple states in which you will get. And then this growth of scientific knowledge. How, given a paradigm, if X1 persons are following that paradigm, then the dynamics is governed by dx1 by dt, alpha 1 x1 n minus n, this is a logistic growth, and some of the people lose interest in that paradigm, they lost. So eventually you find that the equilibrium, that eventually in the saturation, n1 minus d1 by alpha 1, that is the number of scientists you will have. And if a new paradigm comes, that in biological evolution it is a mutation. Like a mutation takes place, a new paradigm comes, and then this paradigm starts competing with the existing paradigm. Under what conditions? These are the. Under what conditions the new paradigm will be stable and it will start eliminating? Under what conditions they can coexist? Under what conditions they will eliminate one? One species, the superior one, will eliminate the bigger one. So beta equal to 1, if they are exactly the same resources, same ideal broadly, then you find replacement of the existing paradigm. So long as this condition is there, the new paradigm will dominate the other paradigm beyond. And if membership of research and networks overlap but need not be identical, then emergent paradigm completely replaces the existing paradigm. And similarly, you say emergent paradigm as well as existing paradigm will coexist, only under this condition where you find the number of scientists researchers using almost similar framework, then they can coexist. Actually, this whole idea by Kuhn's how science grows. There is a normal science, initially there is emergent paradigm, it is able to explain many things, normal science. After some time you find that many things we are not able to explain within the framework of normal science. And then we start. And the new paradigm comes, then the number of anomalies which we are not able to explain within the one paradigm, you find that it increases. And then a new paradigm comes like this. And you have successive evolutionary path. One paradigm comes, this declines, a new paradigm comes. And this is the process of growth of knowledge. And number of Sturman, Kuhn, Sturman at MIT, Sloan School of Management, he also a lot of work in this. The Russians have also done a lot of growth of knowledge, how knowledge grows. And this is emergence, normal science, crisis, revolution. Scientific revolution, when you reach a stage, a new paradigm comes, you find, like from classical physics to quantum mechanics, for the revolutionary phase. Now, ICT diffusion. Now we are talking about information communication, diffusion and ICT. Particularly if you have interactive communication technology. So long as you say that there is a television, color television, it does not matter whether you have it or not. If I have it, I will enjoy that television. But if I have email, unless you have it, it has no meaning for me. So it is an interactive communication technology. So in this context, the sociologist Rogers defines critical mass just like atomic bomb. Unless you have a critical mass, it will not become a bomb. So it means if you reach the critical point, the point in time at which enough individuals have adopted an interactive innovation, that the perceived cost benefit of adopting the innovation changes from negative to positive for individuals, so that a certain minimum number of individuals in the system adopt and the rate of adoption becomes self-sustainable. So it means there is a notion of critical mass. Whatever technology you want to diffuse in the society or educational paradigm, unless we have a critical mass of researchers, it will just come and go. So it means this underlying dynamics of nonlinear mimics the pattern of self-organizing systems. Positive feedbacks accrue in all network diffusion courses as more and more persons adopt a particular network technology, further impetus to others to adopt the same technology. So in this context, ICT, National Mission on Education, this I have suggested that unless we reach this critical mass, it will not diffuse, otherwise what will happen, it will come and just 5%, 15% it will come and disappear. So idea is that unless we reach that, attain that critical mass, and then after that it is self-sustaining, and then it will. So in this context, it is the notion of critical mass, particularly for interactive communication technology. So all ICT diffusion, if you are taking in this country or South region, then the notion of critical mass is very, very important. So as ICT as a complex set of technologies, this we have already discussed. Similarly, network data, all these new paradigms like data science, big data and all these things. So communication network, transportation networks, and these are typically network science emerging, ICT and digital environment, knowledge society, why networks we live in a connected, and then this is very interesting study by Milgram. We are all of us in this world are separated by 6 degrees of freedom away, all of us. Because like they performed this experiment, and this experiment they sent a mail from Africa to someone in US. So within 6 hops you can read, and mathematically you can also show that it is a 6 degrees of away, all of us. Okay, so now you can keep adding. So information network, AIDS blog network. So these are all basically different type of researchers, map of the backbone of science. Then you have the replacement dynamics giving this. Now question people are arguing, is distance education will replace face-to-face teaching? University system. But you will find that the best solution would be when you have a coexistence of everything. Any education policy which aims at replacing face-to-face will lose much significance. I think that is a matter of discussion, lot of discussion. ICT is a very useful supplementary effort as a teaching aid both in synchronous and asynchronous modes. Education policy should be designed in a way to promote multi-dimensional personality in which ICT can play a major role. Similarly, empowering role of ICT, especially in remote inaccessible areas where this becomes very essential. Similarly, we have also looked at economic and technological such process in complex adaptive. These are all evolutionary paradigms, biological evolution, and if you have the diffusion, and this is the idea which was given by Manfred Eigel, a Nobel laureate in biochemistry, so whole biological evolution, and why all your evolutionary computing paradigms basically is based on biological, that is Darwin's evolution. Given this Darwin's evolution, so you have something like this, where there is a diffusion operators and this. So those who are above this, they will survive rest of it. So it is a hill climbing, so the expected value, and once something is over, above that, it will survive. Another interesting aspect, in a country like developing countries, if you take up technologies which are require large number of parameters, say for example, thermonuclear fusion, it is an 8-dimensional parameter space in which you require fluid dynamics, magnetic dynamics, so many things. The probability of success starts declining. Exponentially, that is log n, so if you find, this is the probability of success will be exponential, the number of solutions for each constant. So if you have problems only in one dimensional space, the probability of success is very high. If you go to two dimensional space, the probability becomes less. So it means if you are bringing two or three disciplines together, then the probability is, you have to see whether how many dimensionless constants are there, whether you, but the real success you will get, because in many branches, when you bring probability and number theory, you start getting due result. But if you continue in the same branch, the probability of success, if you continue algebra, whole life you may spend, but still the meaningful result would be. But if you bring some different discipline, like Monte Carlo method is nothing but probability and quadrature, you bring together, you find there are a lot of new results which have come. So the genius of an individual inventor sometimes allows them to cut cost and time by going directly to the correct regime of the dimensionless constant of vector without conducting model tests or model problems. So here is the role of the genius. So if in the search space, if it is n-dimensional search space and if you just hit close to that, that is a genius. But otherwise, there are random walk analysis. If you execute a random walk in knowledge space, probability you may get success or not becomes very, very low. Now, new area which is coming is sustainable development. Even today, I got 5 minutes. It doesn't matter. So, sustainable development, intergovernmental panel on climate change. Now, there is a course on computational sustainability. Now, this Cornell University data center summit, more CO2 than Argentina and Netherlands. Implications for climate change, renewable energy. Key issues to development policy, complex decisions, management of natural resources. So computational sustainability will give us tools to balance environmental, economic and societal needs. Why computational methods are needed? Experts in all applied mathematics, computer science, statistics, information science and many other disciplines need to work together to support sustainable development. So computational sustainability is an emerging area. The focus is on developing computational and mathematical models, methods and tools, sustainability related applications. So this is Department of Computer Science, Cornell University. So probabilistic reasoning, game theory, agent based models, all these different aspects, your soft computing, everything will become a part of this. And today I received an email from Professor Sudhir Jain, IIT Gandhinagar. They have introduced two new courses, one is on Sustainability Center for Sustainability and there is another center on this, I'm just forgetting. So this struck me, so I So knowledge economy, finally I am coming to the end. Knowledge economy, innovations, scientific breakthrough, how to promote innovation thinking. Now this is a typical branch, you find that the system is in this state. And if there are scientists who are excited, they are going here. If the system is so designed that they can take them from here to here, that is a right type of environment. If the system is so designed that everyone is pulled back, again we continue to be in this dormant state and nothing is happening. So this is broadly I wanted to discuss that, given this, and finally I come to that, given any area, as I have discussed, this area is evolving and finally you find that this area reaches this. And if you find the number of scientists NT and this is time, if I plot this, so this is roughly the life cycle of it. What I am finding, most of us enter into somewhere this time in developing countries. By the time area is almost over, we are entering. With lot of difficulty, we are able to get our papers published in SCI journals. Please note, we should be scared of all these paid journals. So that is going to bring bad reputation to you and to the nation and to the organization, everyone. So basically it is the SCI journals, something like peer review. But now there are, I stay in Pritampura, there are six journals, international journals. I stay in this area, what is it? JNU, Munika, there are six international journals. And there are research associates who are all there, and people left and right. I find that M.Tech students publish four papers and teachers also put their name. So four papers for teachers also. Only yesterday in a committee meeting, we said students, M.Tech, paper published and the teacher's name is all there, that could not be counted out. So many out. So finally we find out of 50-60 papers, not a single paper in SCI journal. Now question is, if we start dismissing everyone, that is also wrong. So I think the collective responsibility of the society, collective responsibility of the academicians, that we have to grow together, all SAARC region has to grow together. So somewhere if we are doing this, then what you will find that you will always be laggard. If there is a 30 years, like I have seen neuroscience, computational neuroscience 1980s, 1950s, Huxley got the Nobel Prize. After that, 1980s, 70s, there were a lot of papers, journals started from Europe, America. But in India, only now we are getting into this. So there is a 30 years and a new paradigm is coming. And even if you are here, so you would be laggards, and by the time this thing will come down, again we will be here. So question is, if we can reduce it, I am not suggesting that we should, if we are here, almost saturation when the area is over. If we continue here, we are finished. So our effort should be made, somehow we can bring it here. Try to reduce it. You can't, because these are the real outstanding genius who introduce a new area. And that is what I was, Nikhil Pal was there, I was giving this talk in this place, IIT BHU. So he says one of the persons in soft computing, it was Datta Mazumdar. So Datta Mazumdar, when Fuzzy System 1965 started, so I think he was around that period he got into it. Then Nikhil Pal, Shankar Pal, Nikhil Pal, and one after another. You found, so they, whatever they contributed, they were contributing to the state of art. And so their papers are cited, they became the leading. But there are others equally outstanding intellectuals, but the mistake they made was this. So it, for all young students, because our time is over, so you should be very aware of what you are, which area you are getting into. Because when our students bring papers, sir, I want to do research, I said, show me which references have you got. They said 1991, 92, 93, and that's all. I said, now you are 2015. Do you have any paper in that, in this year, or last year, or year before last? Either the area is over, or you are doing breakthrough. The probability of your breakthrough is very, very low. So it is better you should take only problems which are topical interest. Only then after that, because knowledge you never know. Somebody can do miraculous work. One should not undermine everything. But what is important, they should get into an area which is can give you. Because only through effort, conscious effort, you can do it. I wish you all very best. Thank you.
Sir, I always feel that our department has a blessing of Almighty that we have privilege to invite an ocean of knowledge at the top. Thanks for very knowledgeable and motivating talk. And then I invite our convener of the workshop, Dr. Reshma Kanchanani, for presenting the summary of the workshop. Right is the ring of words when the right man rings.
Before I start with the summary of the workshop, I would like all the guests to please be on the dais again. Thank you very much. May I again request Professor Chandra, special guest of our validity session, to share a few words with us.
As good as the numbers department is. So if somebody thinks that person contributes significantly in competition area without really using good mathematics, something I don't think is possible. So the best thing will be that some sort of collaboration between commercial department and maths department so that the potential of both faculty could be taken into equation. Otherwise probably things will be half successful, not successful. The other thing was Professor Shantanu Chaudhary in the Department of Electrical Engineering. They have got an entered course in computer technology. So he gave me a call. I said, I'm not in IT anymore. Why are you going to be doing this and so forth? So what he said that BTEC students in IT Kanpur artillery system are very good because they come from JEE and so forth. But for the MTech courses, because most of them come from other universities and things like that actually here, and what he found over the years, that the math background is not that good actually. So they wanted to devise a special course for what we call basic mathematics for technology. And he wanted to have my input that what could be the right combination, right topics in mathematics, which are going to make compulsory for anybody who is doing technology from IIT Delhi. So I think this thing is mostly true for many other places and so on and so forth. So maybe I am biased, but I don't think I am. I certainly suggest that or request computer scientists to really look mathematics differently. Mathematics is not certainly in competition. Mathematics is something for collaboration. That is the important point to understand actually. I think in that respect probably some universities, some places are very well placed. SAU is certainly well placed because of the Department of Mathematics are on computer science. So that opportunity is certainly there. And we should not let that opportunity waste that. Because such opportunities come only once actually, and we should really make best use of it. I think with these words, once again, I'd like to thank Professor Manti and everybody else in this institute, in this university, just to give me a chance to really share from my team's teaching and then having some interaction with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Chandra. So with this, we have come to the end of a very busy and enjoyable 3 days of workshop on soft computing and application. And it's time to now to summarize the achievement we have earned in these 3 days. To begin with, I would like to summarize the participation details. We have a delegates from across all the sub-countries. That is, in total, we have 120 participants. Among them, 53 are faculties from different universities across sub-countries. 5 DRDO scientists. Rest of the people from industry and students from university like IIT Delhi, BHU, Jamia Millia, NIT, MNIT, and MET. All the participants have shown the active participation during the entire lecture delivered by the eminent faculty of ISI Kolkata and SAU in together. And I am very thankful to all the participants for the same. And among the list of the presenters, we had a lecture from Padma Shri awarded Professor S. K. Pal, Emeritus Professor of IIT Delhi, Professor Suresh Chandra, Professor C. A. Muthi, Professor M. K. Kundu, Professor Ashish Ghosh, Professor Sushmita Mitra from ISI Kolkata, and many others. I am very much confident that these lectures in total have provided new dimensions to all of our researchers. I'm right on that, right? So you have gained a lot from this?
Yes.
Certainly I will come to the feedback for the same. We are extremely thankful to the President, South Asian University, for providing us with the partial fund for conducting the workshop along with the ISI Kolkata organizing committee. Without whose support and encouragement, it would be very difficult for us to conduct the workshop at this scale. With the limited sitting arrangement, we have tried to accommodate as many participants as possible for this workshop. And as far as the food goes, we have also arranged the food for the people who are fasting for the Navratras. And we made sure that who are not fasting for the Navratras, the food was without onion and garlic. So finally, with these words, I would like to conclude that with the 3 days of workshop, we have shown us a various application in the area of soft computing, which have resulted from many joint collaboration between industries and academia, both within and outside India. Towards this end, I would like to mention that we would try to organize such a workshop of this level every year and possibly in all sub-countries. So finally, I would like to assure the delegates that your recommendation and suggestion, which I am going to take now, would receive our utmost attention. In the end, I would like to thank all the delegates, organization, volunteers associated with this event for their valuable contributions. Thanks a lot. And now it's time for you to say for your feedbacks and comments for this workshop. Can I have a mic, please?